A Musical Life with Emmy Award-winning film, TV, and theater composer Paul Englishby. If you've seen an episode of the hit BBC detective show Luther, starring Idris Elba, then you've heard the powerful music of Paul Englishby. Paul is also the composer for The Musketeers, another hit BBC television series, and has written music for several productions of the Royal Shakespeare Company, as well as for such movies as Miss Pettigrew Lives for a Day and the 2009 Oscar-nominated film An Education. Welcome to A Musical Life. I'm Hugh Sung. Before we get started, I'd like to share a voicemail message announcing a special concert.
Hello, Hugh. This is Sandra Lippman, board member for Brevora Philharmonic Orchestra in New Jersey. We wanted to share with you that Kate Liu, bronze medalist at the 17th Chopin International Competition in Warsaw, will be the featured soloist at the Brevora Philharmonic Orchestra concert on Sunday, March 20th at 7 p.m. at the Nicholas Music Center, which is at Rutgers University in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Miss Liu is the first American to win any of the top three prizes in the last 20 years of this competition, which is held only every 5 years, so we're very excited about this. Miss Liu is a student at Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia. And Brevora is the first orchestra she is soloing with in the U.S. since winning the Chopin competition. While Kate Liu is giving solo recitals across the country and all over the world, she has no additional orchestral engagements this season, so we think it's exciting for audiences in the New York metro and greater Philadelphia regional areas. Additional information on ticketing can be found at bravoraphil.org and through the Discover New Jersey Arts site. Thanks for this opportunity, Hugh. Bye-bye.
Thanks so much for sending me that voicemail, Sandra, and I wish Kate a fantastic concert. If you'd like to announce an upcoming concert, share a musical story, or just want to leave some feedback, visit amusicallife.com and look for the Send Voicemail tab along the right side of your smartphone or computer screen. I'd love to hear from you. Music brings movies and television shows to life, and in the skilled craftsmanship of a master composer, music can also add a powerful layer of commentary on the stories presented on the screen. Paul Englishby displays a remarkable versatility in the dazzling array of genres he works in and creates. After you listen to this remarkable interview, I promise you'll never watch a movie or TV show the same way again. Paul, what an honor and a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for being here.
It's my pleasure, Hugh.
Well, Paul, now, you're not only an incredibly prolific composer, but you're also an amazing musical chameleon, and I suspect you would have been a world-class psychiatrist if you had chosen to pursue that field. So, because of this, I thought it'd be fun to start off exploring the psychology of your music. Mm-hmm. So, in this first track that we're going to hear, it's actually a mix from your score for season 4 of the BBC hit show Luther, starring Idris Elba.
Thank you.
I'm really struck with how you have the single harmony in the opening, and it seems to convey a sense of, I don't know, granite. The chord just kind of stays the same. It's the same harmony. But mm-hmm. somehow within that harmony, you infuse layer upon layer of these sparse melodic fragments and single notes and sound effects. And then the musical scene shifts. And then we hear this simple piano tune interspersed with these, I don't know, these disturbing audio crumbles. Were they distorted vocals or electric guitar samples?
Yeah, I actually use an electric viola.
An electric viola, it sounds so vocal, so interesting. Wow.
But I do sing as well. I use my voice a lot in Luther.
How fascinating.
And treat it with various, effects and electronic devices to change it into something else completely. So sometimes it sounds like a voice. Sometimes it sounds like a synth or a kind of urban kind of gritty sound, you know.
Very much so. And what's interesting is that you juxtaposition that kind of distortion sound with these otherworldly vocal chants. And I think the word that comes to my mind when I'm hearing this kind of montage, this musical montage, is contrast. I mean, everything just screams out contrasts. And so for folks who have never seen the show, it's an amazing show, by the way. Can you describe what you were trying to convey in this mix? And it, to me, I could be wrong, but it sounds like a character study of the lead protagonist, John Luther. And can you just tell us how you use the musical and audio elements to fill in that description?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right there. What I try and do is get inside Luther's head a lot with the music. He's a man who doesn't show a great deal of emotion. He certainly doesn't express it verbally. He's very matter-of-fact with his colleagues. But we know inside his head there's a huge amount of conflict. There's all kinds of emotional memories going on there that we, the audience, are privy to, but his colleagues aren't necessarily. So I can get inside his head with the music and play with memory and confusion and conflict, all these things that he doesn't show. You know, he fills the screen. He's a big kind of macho guy, as you know. So that allows the music to perform that parallel role that we don't see. So you're kind of expressing the unseen, if you like. With the piece you're talking about there, that's the very opening of season four, where Luther is at a crossroads in his life. He's on a leave of absence from his job. He's shacked up in a house on the very edge of a cliff that could easily crumble into the sea at any moment. He's lost his best friend and partner in the end of the previous season. And so I try and get inside his head with that piece. And as you say, there's a kind of static harmony, but that stasis then allows me to feed in sounds, memories of all different kinds, some electronic, some acoustic. I use bass clarinet in there as a kind of drone. The viola, you think you recognize some of these sounds, but you're not quite sure what they are. And I think that's the way our minds work. We never think in a kind of nice F major tune without any kind of without any kind of break in perfect phrases. You know, we get interrupted by confusion and memory and emotional impulse that we have no control over. So that's what that piece is doing, I think. And it's intercut with a sort of dream sequence where he's on the top of a high rise overlooking London, talking about whether or not to jump off. So it's a precarious moment. I wanted to portray the vastness of that London skyline with the long string drones, but also allow all these disparate little sounds and almost sometimes a bit like radio interference and things like that coming in.
Absolutely fascinating. Now, I understand that Sam Miller is the director for Luther, and I was reading several of your other interviews in preparation for this show, and it sounds like Sam encourages you to come up with some rather counterintuitive approaches to a musical score. So let's listen to another example. Now, this clip, again, is still from the Luther show from season one, actually, and this clip is titled Revenge. Now, I have to say, given the title, it was completely not what I was expecting to hear. You know, it seems to, for me, I could be wrong. I haven't finished watching season one yet. So, but but it seems to describe the after effects of revenge rather than the act itself. Now, Luther can be a very gritty, violent show. When I was reading the title, you know, Revenge, I was thinking something pretty straightforward and violent. Mm. And yet, as we can hear, this is completely counterintuitive. Can you describe the scene where we hear this tune and what emotions you were trying to convey with this particular counterintuitive approach?
Sure. Okay. So the scene describes the final capture by the police of a man who drives around in a taxi cab and he picks up young girls and rapes and kills them. He's a horrific specimen of a man. He's finally caught and he's being walked out of the house by the police, and his wife comes up behind him and bludgeons him in the back of the head with a hammer, and that's all done in slow motion. It's a horrific scene. Mm. And Sam Miller is a great guy and a fantastic director, and he always encourages me to write completely free of direction.
Interesting.
Which is not always the case, I can tell you. very often people have very specific ideas, even down to other pieces of music they want you to sound like.
There's actually a question I was going to pose to you. I was going to ask you, you know, with the first track that we heard and this one now, did Sam give you a direction in terms of the kind of soundscapes? But it sounds like he was more or less hands-off and let you really, so this is more credit to you in terms of your psychological mining of the character and of the scene.
Oh, bless you. That's very kind. But what a lot of directors will do, and they're often pressured to do this, is to put temp music in their edits, which is music from other sources or something laid in to give an idea of what should be or what will end up in the final cut, and head the composer off in a certain direction. And Sam, where possible, doesn't do that. Or if he does, he will use something of mine from a previous Luther show, because sometimes it's necessary for producers and execs to hear music and things. But wherever possible, we leave it open for me to experiment. And counterintuitive is an interesting word. It doesn't just mean do the opposite, whatever that might be. From my point of view, it's finding another angle which is dramatically credible. So finding another point of view that the music is looking at this scene from. So it would be very easy to Mickey Mouse what's on screen, or just duplicate what's on screen and do something that describes the bludgeoning of a murderer in the back.
With something loud, with something percussive. Yeah, sure.
And I think in a way that can kind of decreases the dramatic effect of the horror, really, because it becomes unbelievable and you step away. There's a distance between you and what's going on. Mm-hmm. If you do something different, and I think I was trying there was to play the music of the parents of the victims, The deep sadness that surrounds these murders and the knock-on effects, basically, of this man's actions, rather than playing what you're seeing on the screen at that time.
It provides a very profound commentary, almost a subconscious commentary that you give to the literal scene, the visuals that we see, and then, as you say, almost a fable-like message where, yes, revenge is exacted, but it is never enough. You're left with still this emptiness and the sad. That's what I was reading from this incredible decision to score that scene like that. That's incredible.
Well, I tell you, it's a joy to do because it's always fascinating to approach these every scene with a kind of fresh approach. So you go into this knowing that you're not going to pretty much I hardly ever score the scenes as you would first think. This is how I should score the scene. Do you know what I mean?
I think so. Yeah.
I think, you know, the direction, the acting, everything is already there. You know, so you're adding something. You're adding a counterpoint, really. You know.
Have you ever been in a session with Mr. Miller or perhaps any other director, and you know, you have to show you run through the clip with your approach it, and have you ever had the director simply go, "Wow, I was blown away. That was not what I expected." But it is, you know, and have you had those situations where you just blew the director away and they were like, "Wow, I would never have come up with that approach."
Well, I'd be
don't be modest.
I'm too modest to say that. But I mean, yeah, there have been times where I've played something to a producer or a director and it has been completely the opposite of what they expected, but it gets through and it ends up and then everyone can never remember how it being any other way after a while. But you know, I've had plenty of times, like many of us have, where they absolutely hate what you've done. The first time. So it's always a negotiation. But I'm very lucky with Sam Miller in that he's such a creative and improvisatory, if you like, director. He likes to find things out rather than have them firm in his mind before I start.
And I think there's a great, tremendous deal of artistic trust in your creativity and your approach as well. That must be very.
It's very gratifying. Yeah, it's very gratifying. Yeah. Absolutely, I'm very lucky.
Wonderful. Now let's listen to another one of your scores that takes a more traditional approach, if you will. Now this is the finale from the second season of the BBC series, The Musketeers. Now, what I love about this theme is how you make it sound so distinctive with just a single embellishment.
Thank you.
if I may say, it almost starts out to be like a typical, you know, heroic fanfare. But then you just put just this one little touch and it's like it just gives it a character all its own. And this little touch makes me think of your admiration for the composer Benjamin Britten. Mm-hmm. You had mentioned in another interview how Britten manages to be original yet economical with his musical material while still being emotionally devastating. Can you describe what you mean by being musically economical?
Yeah, I think economical in musical terms means saying what you want to say in the simplest, most direct way possible with the most economical of means. I think we've all heard music where in order to try and fix it or make it more this or more that, you simply add more layers. And I think if one can do something simply and effectively, that for me, that is success. And it's often means stripping things back or focusing on one tiny detail, which will, as you mentioned in the Musketeers theme, which changes it from being a kind of four-square heroic theme into something with a little twinkle in its eye.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. There's mischief.
just to the cadence, just as you're about to get to the end of the line, you think you know where it's going, and you give it a little
twirl, a little wink, a little swish of the saber or the rapier. I love it. And again, it's something that I find myself drawn to your music for, these wonderful, subtle, economical embellishments. It's not too much. It doesn't weigh the theme down. And yet it's like, that's just, wow. The characters summarized in such a tiny little gesture. And I can imagine for a lot of composers, especially composers struggling to find their voice, there's a real temptation to, like with cooking, you know, when you're learning to cook, sometimes you throw every spice that you can think of into the soup and you end up with a horrible goulash instead of just focusing on a few quality ingredients, wouldn't you say?
That's absolutely right. I do think of that analogy a lot, actually.
Do you cook?
I do cook, yeah. I think you just need that one tiny bit of spice occasionally, and that's it in that particular tune. And it's interesting you talk about Britten, because of course Britten was very enamored by 16th century music and the kind of decoration around melody that you get in that period.
And we call this the Baroque period. This is where Bach and many of his contemporaries, and I think this was a period of time where music was known for its over-ornamentation, too much decoration. Wasn't that right?
Well, yeah, I think I'm talking slightly earlier.
Oh, I see. I'm sorry. Okay. Even before that, yeah.
John Dowland and the lute, the songs and where a song or a ballad would be sung, but the player would add little ornaments themselves. I mean, later that scholars have tried to replicate them, write them down accurately. But and you get that in Britten's recitative writing, and you know, in order to express an emotion, there'll be a little ornament, and I find myself doing that in lieu of kind of spice and herbs and spices.
And when we say ornaments, we usually mean just a few very short, fast notes in a given direction to almost spice up the main notes, so to speak, wouldn't you say? Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And we hear it all the time in modern pop music, of course. You know, Beyoncé is full of ornaments. It's a kind of vocal thing as much as anything. Of course, in jazz singing as well, you know, you'd never hear somebody singing a tune absolutely straight.
Yeah, yeah. Now, here's another track that you composed for the same series we've just been mentioning, The Musketeers Season 2. Now, this one is titled The Ravine. Now, I love how musically descriptive this is. It sounds like something. And I haven't seen this, you know, the show yet, but just from the music itself, it's so picturesque. It's so lively. It sounds like something dangerous happening where one false step could bring disaster.
Well, maybe you absolutely got it.
It sounds like you're tiptoeing the edge of a cliff or fighting on top of a tightrope. Again, it's amazing because the way the music sounds, it brings to mind this sense of musical economy where rather than the notes, it's really the empty spaces between these tight musical fragments that heighten the tension in the scene. And yet you still, even with these small fragments, you still recognize the key character themes. Mm-hmm. Now that we've heard this, can you describe the scene that you were scoring for and how you used the various musical elements to bring that scene to life?
Okay, well, you're absolutely right in many of your descriptions there. There's a cliff edge and there's a tightrope and all those things you mentioned.
Oh, I got it. Well, it kind of helps that you have the name of the ravine in the title, but I think it's a credit to you too, because your music, you know, many people said that when Mozart wrote his compositions and performed them, that his music was so evocative that people would literally see images. They would see visuals. And I think that's a credit to you, because when I heard this, I was seeing a very vivid scene and all the actions. You really brought that to life.
Well, thank you so much. And I think it's kind of what's great about my job is that, conversely, earlier we were talking about playing what's not in the scene with Luther and playing in the psychology of a guy. And here, this is the opposite. This is where I play absolutely everything you see, because that's absolutely right for the style of the show. And you basically want to heighten all the romance. You want to heighten all the action. You want to hit every hit. And it's really great fun to do, especially with a big orchestra. So in that scene, basically, we have our heroes have bust a guy who was captive in a castle by the Spanish, and they've got to get him out of the castle. They've got to get him across a field, get him across a ravine via a kind of tightrope, while they're being shot at by these Spanish guys. You see, so.
Now I have to, like I said, I have not seen this. I haven't seen any episodes, so I was totally imagining this tightrope scene.
Great, and then the Spanish get closer, and there's a sword fight, and eventually they fight them off, and they all get across, and you'll hear the sort of release of the theme as the two remaining musketeers get across just before the end there. So yeah, I kind of tease the tune out really.
Yes.
And it was designed that way, really, that the theme essentially just rises, ascends in pitch. And so I wanted something that I could tease out. And then when they prevail in each episode, as they always do, we finally hit the top note of the theme, you know.
So, reached it.
it's really great fun to do, I have to say.
Oh, my goodness. And I think it's really helpful to hear both, you know, the theme as it's normally heard, and then to hear this variation where the theme is just coming out a little bit at a time, fighting, and then finally succeeds in being heard in its entirety. It's a tremendous dramatic tool that you play with musically. It's amazing.
Brilliant. Thank you so much.
No. You're brilliant. Thank you. Now, you've written music for, in addition to film and TV, mm-hmm. you've also written music for so many productions by the Royal Shakespeare Company. Now, that in itself, I imagine, must have given you tremendous insight into the psychological contexts for music. I mean, being, you know, as part of your job to have to read Shakespeare and interpret it day in, day out, that's amazing.
Well, you know, I do quite a lot of theatre, and I love the fact that I get to get out of the house a bit, you know, and hang out with other people, because, you know, writing for screen can be kind of a solitary occupation. So I love to do theatre and get out into rehearsal spaces with people and into the theatre when we put the shows on. And yeah, I'm so lucky to have done about half the canon of Shakespeare plays.
My goodness.
And it's not the reading of them, it's the sitting down and the hearing them and watching them grow in the rehearsal room and watching the actors discover their characters and their roles and really get to know the plays that, you know, it's like going back to school. It's incredible. You know, I learn these things. I think I know them vaguely, and then I really get under the skin of the plays. And of course, it helps enormously with my other writing. You know, it helps dramatic context and character and all those things that I come to use in all my work.
Now, when you're writing music for a Shakespeare play, now you obviously don't have to have music running nonstop throughout the whole play, filling every dialogue act. But we actually have an example of one of your works for King Richard II. This is titled Lacrimosa, which I understand is the Latin word for weeping. Is that correct?
That's right, yeah.
Can you describe the scene that this vocal trio, it sounded like a vocal trio. Can you describe the scene that this was written for?
Yeah, so our production of Richard II opens with the funeral of the Duke of Gloucester, who Richard has actually had murdered. We don't know that at the time. It was one of his adversaries in court. So the stage is set. There's a coffin on the stage, and it's the funeral of the Duke of Gloucester. So we start the show with a Lacrimosa, having already heard as the audience come in before the show actually starts. I wrote a kind of requiem for three sopranos. So that brings us into the atmosphere of the play, and then once the show actually starts and the actors start to appear, we hear the Lacrimosa.
I'm purposely trying to show all these incredible gems from your writing because it shows the scope of your musical imagination.
Thank you so much.
Oh, so we're moving on. So in 2009, you won an ASCAP award for your score to the movie Miss Pettigrew Lives for a Day. Now, ASCAP actually stands for the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers. Now, in this track titled Edith's Beauty Salon, we get to hear your jazz and big band chops. We'll be right back. Can you tell us about your early jazz education and the Paul Englishby Big Band?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, jazz has been a kind of parallel passion of mine sort of growing up. So I had classical piano lessons and did, you know, music at school. But I was always, from about the age of 12, 13, I guess, when I heard Oscar Peterson for the first time.
Oh, yes.
And I just got the bug, you know, an absolute, it just bowled me over. And then I just, I tried to learn how to play all these things. And then I joined a local big band in my town. And I started arranging for the big band as a teenager. And so it's always been a kind of a string to my bow and a real passion of mine. And occasionally I get, you know, in my day job, I get to use it, as in the example you just gave. Sometimes, you know, these things come up and I get to use my big band chops, as you say. it's fabulous. And so when I went to study composition at the Royal Academy of Music, and when I was there, I met some guys who were also into jazz. You know, I did the straight composing course there, but there was also a jazz course, which now is common, but it wasn't so much in those days. You know, not, it was kind of a side thing, and looked down on a bit by some of the snooty professors. You know, so I met some guys and we started a band, and for want of a better name, because I wrote all the music, it's called the Paul Englishby Big Band, and we just play original stuff.
Oh, wow. Cool.
And as I say, when I get a chance to do it, to use them on screen, I'll do that as well. It's fantastic.
Are these the same original players that you met from your college days that are still in your big band?
Pretty much, yeah, pretty much.
Do you still get a chance to play just normal gigs outside of the film, TV, theater industry?
Yeah, I did one at Christmas, actually.
Oh, lovely, so, lovely.
I mean, it's harder and harder to get them all together because they're all so busy. They've all become, you know, hugely successful musicians, and they're all hugely busy. So logistically, it's difficult to get everyone in the same room at the same time, but it's great fun when we do.
Oh, that is so wonderful. Now, you received an Emmy Award for the score to the television movie Page 8, which is a BBC spy thriller about an aging 60-something MI5 agent in a post-9/11 world. What is it about jazz that fits so perfectly with spy genres? Can you comment on that? Because it's just perfect.
I don't know. I guess spy, real spies, as David Hare will tell you, who wrote Page 8 and did a lot of research, obviously, with Real spies are nothing like the spies, these spies you see on TV and in films. But, you know, the film and TV idea of spies, you know, they're glamorous. They also improvise in order to, you know, in order to discover what's going on. They have to get out of scrapes by improvising. And so maybe jazz is the perfect music because of that. And it's glamorous. It swings. I mean, if you see Bill Nighy walking down the side of the Thames at the beginning of page 8, then it has a swing rhythm to that gait, you know, the way he walks.
It's very subdued. It's not jazz in your face, but it's very cool. It's very laid back, and it's very
I mean, what I love about that sort of particular kind of 60s jazz is that it kind of keeps its cards to its chest a bit.
Yes.
But then it can explode with a huge, you know, if you listen to that kind of music, you suddenly get these huge stabs of full band. Mm. And I think, you know, that, I mean, John Barry made it famous with the Bond, the original Bond,
sure,
scores, with those big band stabs have just become synonymous with spies. But it's that ability that to suddenly become extremely dangerous, having been very, very cool. It's great fun.
Wonderful. I have to say, your orchestral score for the 2009 Oscar-nominated film, An Education, is absolutely enchanting. Again, I have to confess, I haven't seen the movie, but as I was listening to your score, I was falling in love with your melodies because you have such intricate geometries with crafting the line. And yet, even with those intricate melodic shapes, you still manage to juxtaposition these complex lines with deceptively simple textures. Now, can you tell us about the characters that you are trying to convey with this score and what musical elements you apply to bring them out?
Mm. Well, I began basically with Jenny's theme, a very simple theme on a piano, which I tried really to represent innocence and purity, because the film is about a young girl who gets basically chatted up by this older guy who falls under his spell, enters his world of glamorous friends, and she, you know, she starts to behave all grown up, much to the chagrin of her parents, and going off to concerts and a little bit too, you know, early for her years, and really falls for this guy's shtick, and it turns out in the end that he's a bigamist and he's married, and and it's based on a true story. But I wanted the score to capture Jenny, really concentrate on Jenny. I didn't really have to concentrate on the other characters, because wherever they went there was hip music playing, you know, this kind of rock and roll. So I really wanted to paint a picture of Jenny and the despite what's happening to her, where she's going with these people, there's still a young girl underneath all that, and she has to ultimately return to that in the end, to find real wisdom, really. And there's wisdom in innocence, I think. So simplicity was the key. And I don't particularly like muddy orchestral textures anyway. I like to always hear every line. So even when the music is quite contrapuntal, there may be three or four things going on, the scoring is very transparent. So it's scored for strings, a few woodwinds, harp, and piano.
And the piano is representing Jenny. And I have to say, is that correct? It sounds like the piano. Yeah. You managed to create this incredible theme that's sweet, and yet, you know, there is something complicated there. Sweet, innocent, and yet more than meets the eye. It's really fascinating.
Well, thank you. And she is, I mean, I wrote that tune before they shot anything, actually, on the
basis. Oh, really?
The script. I was on board quite early for that film. And so just reading the script, that tune jumped out at me. I mean, she's a young girl, and she's innocent in terms of worldly affairs, but she's very bright and very clever, and she ends up going to Oxford, and she's, you know, she's, so it's not sort of thumb sucking innocence. It's kind of bright eyed innocence.
Mm, mm, mm. So, I'm wondering, when you were growing up, mm-hmm. were there any particular movies or TV shows where the music really jumped out and made an impact on you?
Oh, all sorts.
Yeah. Are there any that come to mind? Anyone that, any couple that really inspired you to think that maybe someday you could be one of those people making the music for those kinds of movies or shows?
Well, there are two films that just jumped to mind when I was a teenager, but one of them wouldn't be appropriate because all the music was by Mozart. Amadeus, I don't know if you've seen the film.
Oh, of course. Oh, what a wonderful movie. And it's so brilliantly, I mean, scored in the sense of taking Mozart's work and fitting it into the drama of the movie so perfectly.
Yeah, Milos Forman. And they didn't edit any of Mozart's music in terms of chopping into it inappropriately. They let it play. And it's a really great example of letting the music play out, not rushing to speed up the cut or speed up the scene. And the scenes where Salieri is reading scores by Mozart in intense jealousy, and you're hearing each element of the music come in as he describes strings.
That was brilliant.
Bow, whatever it is. Absolutely brilliant. I mean, that was mesmerizing. Another one, I think, would be The Mission, Ennio Morricone's score to Roland Joff film. And it's the music that stands out for me. It's absolutely stunning music. If anyone gets a chance to hear The Mission by Ennio Morricone, has a huge palette of instruments and percussion and choir. And I just remember these big wide shots, landscape shots with this music playing over the top. It's absolutely glorious.
He's been such a towering, influential figure in the world of film music. Just a wonderful, wonderful composer. Oh my goodness!
And it's a real tribute to the respect that music is given in those films, I think, which it isn't always given. You know, so if you've got Ennio Morricone, I believe that Tarantino did actually just let him write what he wanted for Hateful Eight.
You know, isn't there something to be said when, and hopefully there's some TV and film directors out there listening to this. Hey, guys, trust your composers. Let them have some creative reign there.
Well, that's right. Bernard Herrmann used to say, you know, I'm the expert. I'll do the music.
Now, we seem to be Now, tell me if I'm wrong, but we seem to be in a new golden age of television. We've got these incredible productions from the BBC, HBO, of course, Netflix, Amazon coming up, and so many other incredible resources. I'm wondering, is this translating into a new golden age for TV and film composers as well, from your perspective?
Well, I think what it's going to do is going to up our game, really. I think we're going to have to up our game. This is an age of on-demand long seasons. So you can literally sit there and watch 6 hours of television. So 6 hours of a story in one go. And people do. So rather than waiting a week to watch the next episode, you know, you can, like they call it binge watching, don't they?
Yes.
But what that means is we as composers have to be careful how we structure our music, our themes. Do you know what I mean? So we're not dealing in the micro. We're dealing in the macro as well.
Interesting.
In the long arc of the score, because people are going to be hearing this music, and there won't be a week till you hear the next time. And it has to build in the same way that the drama and the characters are building. We can't just glibly kind of accompany something. It has to be thought through carefully, I think.
It's funny because I'm a big sci-fi fan. I'm recalling the old original Star Trek episodes, and as a musician, of course, they had the same four or five tracks. Whenever there was a canned bit of drama, you'd hear the same theme pump in and out. And you know, it's once, as you said, if you're watching the episode, you know, once a week, it's okay. But if you're watching this back to back, it gets annoying very quickly. So it's interesting that you mentioned that you have to really plan the arc of the score very much like the arc of an entire series has a dramatic high point. You have to kind of think of your score in that way too, don't you?
I think that's where we're going. Yes, I think we can't just, you know, as you say, reuse the same three or four bits of score whenever there's a bit of tension. Put a bit of tension music in. It has to develop and it has to keep you riveted.
Does this give you more pressure as a composer to have to produce more music more quickly since they all come out at once? Or how has this phenomenon of binge watching and binge production affected your work timeline?
Well, it's getting squeezed anyway, whether that's because of this phenomena or, I mean, I think because of digital technology and the fact that you can fiddle around with your film and keep editing until the last moment. When I first started, we cut the first thing I'd ever did on film. And you kind of had to decide on a cut, and that was it. and say, right, it's locked, you know. But now things don't get locked, so you think you've scored something, and then they'll tell you they've rearranged something, they've chopped this, and you know, it's never two bars or four bars. It might be like three-fifths of a bar, so you've got to kind of make it work again. So all those things affect the timeline. And I think, you know, music's the last thing to go on. And things get moved back and moved back and moved back, apart from your delivery date. So everything else gets pushed. And so it can, you know, it can be a bit of a scramble, but I try and be organized.
So can you give us a little bit of an insight into this kind of production schedule? What is a typical, let's break it apart. For a TV episode, what is a typical amount of time that you're given to score an episode for a television show?
So if you take Musketeers, which is fairly typical, I do two per month. So it's about 2 weeks per episode. I'll get an episode and I'll watch it with the director, maybe the producer, and we'll do a thing called spotting, which is where you go through the episode and you decide where music's going to go and what the music is going to do, what its function is. then I'll go away and I like to demo a whole episode at a time rather than a cue at a time, so that I can kind of get the shape of the whole thing. So I'll demo on kind of synths, a mock-up of what the orchestral score will sound like. And then I'll send that out to the director and producers, and I'll get notes back. On a good day, there's not very many. On a bad day, there's lots. And then I'll work on the notes, and we'll go back and forwards maybe two or three times, and then it'll get signed off, and then I can get it orchestrated and record it with the orchestra. And I'll do two. So I do two at a time. So I have a session, a recording session, full day with an orchestra per month.
So just to get a frame of mind, just after you've seen the episode, you have about a week to go back and forth to put the scoring together. Is that correct? And then
I need to write it in about a week.
Oh my goodness!
And with something like Musketeers, there's about 45 minutes per episode.
Oh my goodness.
So it's a lot of music.
And then you have to score it and then print it, and then you have one day with the orchestra to get it recorded. Is that correct?
Well, on a big thing like this, I have help with the orchestration.
Okay, okay.
Something like a single film, I'll do all the orchestration myself. But okay, Something like this, I'll have help, and we'll all hands on deck with copyists and all that sort of thing, to get those parts on the stands.
That's incredible. But you were looking at approximately a week and a half, 2 week production on your end for each episode. Is that correct?
That's right. Yeah.
And then for, let's say, for a movie, a TV film or even a larger movie, what does the time production look like for that? I think I heard a horror story of the composer for Hidden Dragon. What was it? The Hidden Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. I think was Tandun the composer for that one. I can't remember.
But yes,
and he was given like 1 week, and he had to try to get Yo-Yo Ma to record this thing. He had 1 week to throw the score together. I mean, I can't even imagine. It came out beautifully, but is that typical for a full length motion picture?
It's a lot more chaotic than you might imagine. You hear all sorts of stories. Every single film is different. Sometimes it works like a dream and you've got plenty of time. Sometimes, you know, you may be brought on very late. There may be, there's been a problem with the previous composer, and that happens a lot where people get replaced very late. Or I think about a month is the shortest I've had to do a movie.
I was going
to
ask you, what was your craziest time deadline that you ever had to face for any project? What was the shortest amount of time you had to produce something?
Okay, my very first show at the Royal Shakespeare Company was drafted in during the technical rehearsals in the theater the day before the show.
Oh, yeah. No.
Yeah. Basically, the composer they hadn't written anything.
Oh, no.
And I've had some kind of terrible writer's block and just didn't do anything. So somebody called me up and said, "Can you come in?" So I sort of kind of wrote it as they were staggering through the play on the stage.
And, oh, my goodness.
And handing bits of paper to the musicians who were in the pit.
And this was handwritten music. And how much music did you have to come up with on one day's notice?
Oh, I don't know. There was a song as well.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Okay, I think you win the award for pressure writing. Yeah. Incredible. Wow. So I have one final question for you, Paul. If you could go back in time and choose any film to be the composer for, which film would that be and why?
I mean, that's such a difficult question, because the films that you want to be, that you admire them because the music's so perfect.
that's a good point. I guess the question I'm really asking is, because you're so immersed with film and TV and in the entertainment industry, what would you want to watch for your own enjoyment? And do you ever come across a movie where you think, well, the movie is pretty good, but the music, I don't know. And you could think, well, I wish I could have done it such and such a way. Or maybe an older film that had a different kind of...
Well, I think what I always love that story that the MGM studio orchestras, that the one thing they were terrified of was Tom and Jerry. Because Scott Bradley's scores were ferociously difficult.
Difficult, incredible writing, amazing, yeah.
Absolutely, he was a stunning composer in his own right. He studied Schoenberg and the serial school of 12-note writing. He was a real modernist, and here he was writing Tom and Jerry scores, and they terrified the session musicians, you know. And I think I'd love to have a go at one of the old Tom and Jerry's and try and do those kind of orchestral acrobatics that he does, and then suddenly you're into a little standard jazz tune, and then it goes off into kind of mayhem, you know, but so precisely scored and so difficult to conduct and to play, I'd imagine, to follow the action, that would be great fun, I think.
Yeah, I think people don't always appreciate. You have to watch a Tom and Jerry score, turn off the video and listen to just the music, because you start to realize this music was insanely difficult. Incredible.
Yes. Yeah, talk about time signature changes.
Rhythmic things and crazy clusters. And so I have to apologize. I said that was my last question. I think my real question was, if you had a dream project, everything, you had no limits in terms of time, money, musicians, whatever, what would your dream music or movie or film or theater project be to produce the music for? What would you envision?
I think it would be a film of, you know, like the like a Dr. Zhivago or something of epic with grand passion, with a huge orchestra, with plenty of time to record it, but not too much time. You know, you hear about the time that some of these movies get. Unbelievable months of orchestras sitting around while they record kind of 10 seconds a day. You know, I could write it with the orchestra sat right there for in less time. But I think, you know, a comfortable amount of time with the orchestra and conducting myself, something with grand passions and possibly a ballet dream sequence.
Wonderful. So, Paul, before I let you go, why don't you share with us some of the things that are coming up next for you in your writing, anything that's coming up in terms of your calendar for the next couple of projects?
Yeah, well, I'm just finishing off series 3 of Musketeers. I'm actually in the middle of the final episode.
Ooh!
So that's coming up quite soon, and that plays obviously in the States as well as here, so you'll be able to see that on BBC America. And then I start a ballet, which is really exciting, full-length ballet for a major ballet company, who will make an announcement on the 16th of February, I believe. And until then, I'm not allowed to say what it is or who the company is, but suffice to say they're a major ballet company not far from where you are.
Oh, fantastic. Congratulations. I can't wait to we'll probably have the information by the time this episode comes out. We'll put this in the show notes too. That'll be so exciting.
Yeah, hopefully. Yeah. I think 16th of February, they mentioned that they're doing their new season announcement, so they didn't want me to spoil it. Great. Well, that'd be great.
Well, Paul, if you ever need a second pianist to join you for one of your scores, please give me a call. I would love to sit in on one of your sessions one of these days.
Bless you, Hugh. That's been wonderful. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show.
No problem.
For links to Paul's website, as well as news on his ballet project and details on the Royal Shakespeare Company's King and Country Tour featuring Paul's music, visit the show notes at amusicallife.com. While you're there, be sure to sign up for our weekly newsletter to get the latest updates on show guests and special events. And if you enjoy this show, I hope you'll take a moment to post a quick review on iTunes by going to amusicallife.com/review. Don't forget, You can also send me your feedback or your own musical stories by voicemail by going to amusicallife.com and looking for the Send Voicemail tab along the right side of the screen with your smartphone or computer. I'd especially love to hear about some of your favorite movie or TV music themes. Until next time, I'm Hugh Sung, and I wish you a musical life.